Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's get started and look into the first article. The first article of discussion is about generalized system of preferences. The generalized system of preferences is a US trade program designed to promote economic growth in the developing world, where the US government selects a group of poor developing country and its set of products, and it offers these countries lower than the normal tariffs. What this US generalized system of preferences program further allows is duty-free exports of some products. Under the present context, India was the major beneficiary of this program. India exported products worth $5.6 billion under the program in 2017, the highest among all beneficiaries. But with the economic changes seen in United States of America and the policy of USA First, President Donald Trump has announced that he intends to end the preference awarded to India. So what this GSP is all about? How this move of USA will impact India? Will our exports suffer? What India has to say about this withdrawal? Options that are left with India will all be discussed in a video that will be uploaded very shortly. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article says 15 of the 20 most polluted cities in the world are in India. So what is the context? According to the latest data compiled in the IQ Air World Air Quality Report, prepared in collaboration with the Greenpeace, the report goes on and says 15 of the 20 most polluted cities in the world are located in India. The ranking relies on the ground-based sensors that were located in 3,000 cities across 73 countries, and this was compiled by the IQAR Group, which is a major manufacturer of air monitoring sensors as well as the purifiers. This report has taken into picture and has measured particulate matter 2.5. So the most important point that we have to understand here is, what is a particulate matter? So a particulate matter is one of the common proxy indicators that is used as an indicator for air pollution. This particulate matter affects more people than any other pollutant. The major components of the particulate matter are sulfate, nitrates, ammonia, sodium chloride, black carbon, mineral dust, as well as water. So it constitutes a complex nature of solid as well as liquid particles of both organic and inorganic substances suspended in the air. There are two types of particulate matter. The first particulate matter is the particulate matter 10. So what this 10 basically means here is, it has a diameter of less than or equal to 10 micrometer. So all those particles which are 2.5 to 10 micrometer in diameter are called as the coarse particles. So this particulate matter 10 can penetrate and lodge deep into the lungs and can also cause health damages. Another important particulate matter is particulate matter 2.5. So it is this particulate matter 2.5 that was used in this particular report. The particulate matter 2.5 are those particles that are less than 2.5 micrometer in diameter. This particulate matter can enter the lung barrier, enter the bloodstream, while contributing to the risk of developing cardiovascular and respiratory disease as well as lung cancer. Since this particulate matter 2.5 is dangerous for the health, it needs certain regulation. So when we look into the World Health Organization, it has come up with a standard for the permissible levels for the particulate matter 2.5, where it has said 10 micrograms per cubic meter on an annual basis is what the standard that has to be maintained in a particular country. But India's standard national ambient air quality standard for PM 2.5 is about 40 to 60 micrograms per cubic meter, depending on whether they are residential or industrial areas. So what it means is, the World Health Organization has set a particular standard and India has almost 4 times higher to this particular standard. So let's look into some of the statistics to understand what this article goes about speaking. So according to this particular survey, what it has gone on saying is that when ranked by the country, Bangladesh emerged as the most polluted. This is followed by Pakistan and India respectively. China is the 12th most polluted country in the world. Of the countries analyzed, Iceland emerged as the one with the cleanest air. And further, it goes on to say, every city from West Asia and Africa included in this report exceeded the World Health Guidelines for Particulate Matter 2.5, as did 99% of the cities in South Asia, 95% in Southeast Asia, and 89% in East Asia. So what this means is that people in the world will be suffering from air pollution, they will have health impact, they'll lose a lot of labor because of the health issues, and also majority of the people will be investing on the medical costs, and this is the major problem when it comes to the air pollution. So when we look into the data, Gurugram tops it, it is followed by Ghaziabad and Faisalabad of Pakistan. So whenever there is a question regarding air pollution, kindly make sure that you remember these data. This can be used in your answer writing as well as in the essay as well. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article speaks about smart fencing. Let's look into the background first. India-Bangladesh riverine section is considered highly porous. The region is known for illegal immigration, smuggling of arms and ammunition, as well as other goods as well. In a bid to check this illegal immigration, smuggling of arms and ammunition, drugs and cattle, Assam will be put under electronic surveillance. When we look into the statistics, Assam shares a 263-kilometer border with Bangladesh. Much of this border was fenced, but a 61-kilometer stretch in the Dhubri district remained open owing to the terrain dictated by Brahmaputra. So because this particular region was not fenced and the government had to stop the illegal immigration, they came up with a particular program, and that program was what is called as the smart fencing. So this smart fencing will be operationalized along the 61-kilometer riverine section of the international border in the Dhubri district of Assam, where the Brahmaputra enters the Bangladesh. So this particular program of the government of India will cover those areas like the sand islands, riverine channels, which makes the border guarding difficult during the rainy season. In order to overcome all these issues, the government has come up with a unique program which is called as the Bold QIT. This Bold QIT stands for Border Electronically Dominated QRT Interception Technique. So what this means is, this particular program was established under the Comprehensive Integrated Border Management System. This Bold QIT aims to install various kinds of sensors across the sand islands as well as the riverine channels. This entire span of Brahmaputra will be covered with data network, which will be generated by microwave communication, OFC cables, DMR communication, day and night surveillance cameras, as well as intrusion detection system, as explained under this article. So these gadgets will provide information to the border security force control rooms along the border areas and enable the paramilitary forces for quick reaction to stop any possibility of illegal border crossing as well as crimes. So what is the significance of this program? The implementation of this project will not only help the BSF curb all types of cross-border crimes, but also provide respite to the troops from round-the-clock surveillance. So this is what we need to understand under this particular article. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article speaks about the Hanoi setback. To understand the background of it, to understand the relationship of United States of America with North Korea, and the brief background, we have already explained on 25th February 2018 under the 8th topic, North Korea and US all set for Hanoi Summit. So kindly look into it for the background so that you will be clear of what this Hanoi Summit is. Currently, we will be focusing on this particular summit and what has been the outcome of this summit. So let's try and understand what this article goes about explaining. For a country to develop nuclear weapons, it has to invest a substantial amount of resources, and it also has to overcome a number of international hurdles as well as sanctions. This means that whenever there is a country wanting to come up with its nuclear program, it has its certain clear objectives. These objectives can be in the form of security threat that may be emanating, or it can be a political agenda as well. So behind the pursuit of all these nuclear weapons, there is a clear objective as to why a country is raising up the nuclear weapons. For North Korea and its dictator Kim Jong-un, the first objective is regime survival. With human rights violations committed and international norms being violated repeatedly, surviving will require nuclear blackmailing. So what this regime survival basically means is nuclear blackmailing to make sure that the regime survives. The next important point is it wants to rupture its American alliances, namely Japan as well as South Korea. The third idea as to why North Korea wanted to come up with this particular program is North Korea and South Korean unification and form a single Korea under its own terms and dictations. With this objective in mind, the USA had to counter this particular move of the North Korea. It had to protect its allies and prevent further escalation as well. Therefore, they imposed economic sanctions on North Korea. This led to a lot of suffocation in North Korea, and they wanted this to be addressed. So the US President Donald Trump hoped that he could sell this dream of prosperous North Korea to convince Mr. Kim Jong-un about the merits of denuclearization. So the whole subject matter of the Hanoi Summit is denuclearization of North Korea and lifting up of these economic sanctions that was imposed on North Korea. So the subject matter of Hanoi Summit is denuclearization as well as lifting economic sanctions. This move did not work out in Hanoi, where Mr. Trump and Mr. Kim met for 2 days. There was disagreement and there was abrupt end to this particular meeting. Post this, there was a press conference that was followed by the abrupt ending of the summit, where Mr. Trump informed that Mr. Kim demanded the lifting of these entire economic sanctions in their entirety. So what Mr. Kim Jong wanted was that he wanted the United States of America as well as Trump administration to remove all the economic sanctions in entirety. But at the same time, the North Korea did not agree for the comprehensive, verifiable, irreversible denuclearization. So what was the major glitch in this particular idea was, on one side, North Korea expected United States of America to remove all those economic sanctions imposed on North Korea. On the other side, it was not ready for complete denuclearization, which was the major agenda of the Hanoi Summit. Another important glitch area was, there was also a problem with the sequencing as well. Mr. Kim wanted sanctions to be lifted off first, and at the same time he told that he would make substantial progress on the denuclearization. So on one side he says that all these economic sanctions will have to be removed first and he is not ready to reciprocate, but he says that he will do it eventually on a step-by-step basis. As a result, this particular Hanoi summit did not become a fruitful exercise. So what we have to understand under this particular idea is what are the various concerns that have been voiced under this article. So this abrupt end of talks between United States President Donald Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un in Hanoi is clearly a setback for the peace attempts, a peaceful solution to the Korean nuclear crisis. In 2018, there was Singapore summit that was held. This was the first meeting between Donald Trump as well as Kim Jong-un. When they initially met up, there was a lot of bonhomie. There was a cloud of happiness. There was a sound of understanding between these two leaders. But after the Singapore meet, both sides are also agreed to denuclearize this particular region. They wanted a lasting and a stable peace regime. But what we see under this particular Hanoi summit is no such comments about the future course of action was initiated. In the Singapore summit, there was a growing sense of responsibility to bring up stability in the Korean Peninsula. There was a growth of bonhomie and they had future aspirations as well. But when it comes to the Hanoi summit, the future aspirations has completely become volatile, and they have not commented anything about the future course of action. Another key concern that this article goes on to speak about is, yes, the summit was all about denuclearization. But what we also forgot was the ruthless leadership of Kim Jong-un. He has large charges of massive human rights abuse. The prison camps were filled with dissidents, a near complete absence of the media. Religious and speech freedoms were not given. The famine in the 1990s. So there were hundreds and thousands of people who were killed, and there was also assassination of his uncle as well as the half-brother. So in this particular environment, we have only looked at denuclearization, but we have failed to realize the ruthless attitude of Kim Jong-un, which should have been looked into, is what this article goes about speaking. Next point that we have to understand here is, why was this relationship not transforming into a fruitful exercise? When we looked into the Singapore summit, there was a lot of good nature, there was a lot of understanding between these two countries. But currently, when we look after the Hanoi summit, this has not remained the same. A part of this problem was the failure of both United States of America and North Korea in following up to the commitments that they had laid in the Singapore summit. A few weeks ahead of the Singapore summit, North Korea had announced a complete freeze of nuclear and missile tests as a reconciliatory gesture. It had also asked the United States of America to reciprocate. Its main demand was a formal declaration of an end to the 1950-53 Korean War, and the Trump administration had refused to do so. But when we look into this particular statement, what we have to understand here is that North Korea, as a reconciliatory gesture, had stopped the nuclear missile program for a temporary phase. It also wanted the United States of America to reciprocate by declaring an end to the Korean War. What do we have to understand here is that this 1950-53 Korean War was halted by an armistice treaty or a truce treaty, and this is not ended by a peace treaty. So what this means is that there is war, that it is continuing, but there was a temporary truce or an armistice that was signed during the 50s as well as the 53. So the major hurdle between these two countries is there was lack of confidence building measures from United States of America as well as from the North Korea post this refusal by the Trump administration. American intelligence community also reported that North Korea continued its ballistic missile program after the first Trump-Kim summit. So they had met up in Singapore. Post this, there were certain intelligence reports which United States of America had, and these intelligence reports surfaced that in addition to the principal nuclear facility at Yangon, North Korea had built another uranium enrichment program at the Kangson. Another report indicated, though the Pungri test site was shut, it continued plutonium production and uranium enrichment during the last 12 months, which had enabled North Korea to add up extra 7 devices to its existing arsenal of about 30 devices. So what this means is, on one side, it is sending a reconciliatory gesture. On the other side, it is still continuing with this nuclear program. So these were the major concerns and the issue area that has been surfacing. And as a result, this particular Hanoi summit has become one of the lost opportunities. What is the conclusion that we can derive? So even before the Hanoi summit was stepped into, there were all reports that the US will declare an end to this Korean War, and that both countries would open liaison offices in each other's capitals as part of normalization of ties. What they should be continuing is, they should go ahead with such measures and build confidence and mutual trust, while also take a phased approach to dealing with more contentious issues such as the denuclearization. So this is what we need to understand in reference to this article. So moving on, let's look into the next article. This article speaks about Hamiltonian spite. This refers to the spiteful or the vicious behavior that is exhibited by certain organisms towards other organisms of the same species that is aimed to improve the chances of survival of their own genes. So what we have to understand here is, many animal species exhibit infanticide. The adults tend to kill their young ones or offspring of the conspecifics even if they do not feed on them. One of such example is female wattle jackets. So such behavior is usually common among the organisms, basically to reduce the competition against its genes for the limited resources that have been occupied in that particular area. So in order to make sure that they are surviving in spite of the competition within the same species, such behavior is what is called as the Hamiltonian spite. This particular idea is named after biologist William D. Hamilton. This can be a prospective question in your prelims examination. So this is all what we have to understand from this article. So let's look into the next article. These two articles, that is Algeria for Change as well as Promised Amid Strife, this is not important from the UPSC examination consideration. So that's the reason this has been omitted. So let's look into some of the prelims practice questions. Consider the following statement with respect to IRDAI. It was created on the recommendations of Malhotra Committee report. The agency's headquarter is in Hyderabad. Insurance is a subject listed in the union list. Which of the above statements are correct? The answer is 1, 2 and 3. Let's look into the explanation for the same. All the three answers are correct, and this was constituted by an Act of Parliament called the Insurance Regulatory and Developmental Authority 1999. Why have we picked this up is because the Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority has said that insurance companies should not only rely on external ratings but should also use their own judgment while investing. So because it speaks of IRDAI, that is why we have picked up this question. So moving on, let's look into the next practice question. The Hodeidah port is in Yemen. Why is this in picture? The context is because of the Yemen crisis. So this is also called as Hodeidah, as well as Hodeidah, fourth largest city in Yemen and its principal port on the seaport. This is present here. So kindly look into the map for this explanation. So moving on, let's look into the next one. Consider the following statements. Capital adequacy ratio is the amount that banks have to maintain in the form of their own funds to offset any loss that banks incur if the account holders fail to repay dues. CAR is decided by each individual bank. This is a previous year question paper. Why have we picked this up? Because there is one of the articles which speaks about the capital adequacy ratio. So which of the statements given above is correct? The answer for this is one only. Why? The second option is wrong because it is decided by the Basel III committee and not by the individual banks. So moving on, let's look into the previous year question paper once again. Which of the following is or are among the fundamental duties of citizens laid down in the constitution? The answer for this is 1, 3 and 4 only. So moving on, let's look into the mains practice questions. What led to the failure of talks in Hanoi between USA and North Korea? How should this hostility be reduced going ahead? We have already discussed this. So please write all your answers on the comment section so that we can evaluate and also give you a relevant feedback for the same. So this is it for today. Thank you for watching. All the best.